So, Mark, I hear you're socially isolating, like a lot of people are doing during this this crisis. First of all, I hope you're well. And secondly, you know, what's it like self-isolating? Because a lot of people are doing it now, and a lot of people might have to do it in the future. How's it feel to kind of be confined into a fairly small space?
Well, fortunately, I mean, I can probably gather, I'm in a tiny little office in my flat here, but, well, I'm used to working in my little tiny office in my flat here on my own anyway, so people like me, it's not so difficult to self-discipline myself into being efficient, still doing the work I do, hopefully. And I'm not isolating because of health at the moment. I'm well, but I'm more interested in the World Health Organization advice rather than our governments, because I don't trust our government's advice because it's been chaos. The World Health Organization had a chap who was an ex-employee of them, actually, but he was a World Health Organization chap who said, don't assume you're trying not to get it, assume you have it, and stay at home and not pass it on. So I'm taking that advice because I trust the World Health Organization more than I do Boris Johnson.
Right. And so how's that feeling? I mean, you're just doing a lot of stuff online. I know we've been in touch. Yeah. And I know that I know you're worried about the events organisation as well, and how, I mean, a lot of pubs, bars, theatres are having to, well, not having to close. Do you find it unclear, that advice? Because it's kind of, it's more about people not going to them, avoiding bars, clubs, theatres, etc., rather than actually a complete closure. So maybe, first of all, about that bit, I mean, what do you think of that government advice?
See, that's a good question, Mark, because this is where the government have not thought through the consequences of their words, is that advising people not to go to theatres means that theatres can't claim force majeure for closing venues and contracts, which basically for the layman means, in your insurance contracts, you if you're forced to close, you can at least recover some money from insurance. But at this point, you can't, because only advice. So people aren't going to go to the venues. So effectively, you close the venues without officially doing it, which is to protect insurance companies. That's the only reason they could have done it. And I'm trying to be supportive of the government, but in this case, it does look like they're just protecting their rich insurance company mates. And I think that's shameful and almost criminal, frankly.
And have you had personal experience of this? Because what's happening to the treason show? Because we did speak, actually, just a few days ago about the treason show in Worthing, a new venue in Worthing. So what's been your personal experience, Mark?
Well, we postponed that now for obvious reasons. People weren't able to come. We did have some people booked, but we've refunded them, which I think is the right thing to do. And as an alternative, we're asking people to buy tickets anyway, and then, you know, for this show we just went past, we did refund those. But in future, what we're saying is buy tickets now, and if we postpone, if there's no shows in the end of May, or in this case for us at the end of May or beginning of May, you can use your ticket for a show at a future date. Now, where I'm fortunate is the treaty show is a regular monthly show, more or less. When we get the all clear, which will happen, we will come through all this, and their shows will start up again. If you bought tickets, they'll be valid. So that's the great way to support the treason show at the moment, and other companies and other shows as well. So I would say, you know, that's what that's my approach at the moment. We're also, you know, doing other things I can talk about in a second. But I've done that to ride over what for us. We already knew this was getting bad because we saw our bookings affected a month ago. So the government are behind us, who are self-employed or some traders or renters, you know.
Yeah.
We are very, very concerned that there isn't any apparent help for us. We are just waiting to see what's going to happen, like everybody. There are more interesting critical things going on. The National Health Service, the hospitals, the incredible work they're doing in the care people. So there are priorities involved in life. But, you know, this is across the board.
Yeah.
Economy and disposed for me is the arts and creative industries. So, you know, if we don't support that, our society around us, as we all know, people are going to struggle, if not go under.
Yeah. What about because there was a support package for the government. You've probably been following that, I'm sure, online. I mean, that is some help, isn't it? The grants for music venues, for example. You know, for other venues. So something coming through. But you're saying there's more to be done.
It's not enough, because venues on their own are not the arts. They're the houses of where we put our art. But you know, it's like having you know, releasing one hand that's been tied behind your back, but you've still got the other one tied behind your back. Because you may have a venue and you may be able to cover yourself for a bit, but if you haven't got shows or companies or creators who bring those shows to you, then you're effectively going to go under anyway. So it's yeah. almost I'm trying to think of a better metaphor than it is, too cliche, but hairs and combs and balding men. But it's just be clear about it. It's good. I think that's a positive thing. But they're looking at it, ask about face at least. It's people. It should be about people first. First of all, the stating and test that the World Health Organization have issued again, you know, this advisory. And this government is not doing what it should be doing. It is failing on. It's failing us at the moment. Is how it feels.
Yeah. I know some other issues you wanted to talk about. Let's just finish up on the venues then. So in terms of the venues, you think there's more should be done? I mean, we've got the grants that should help Brighton, you know, or Sussex-based organisations, and hopefully we'll obviously see the Treason Show back up and running once, you know, we've got the all clear, as it were. What else? You know, what's it like isolating? How's it? How are you coping? Because obviously we're speaking via Skype. I mean, is this a new way of working? Should we be doing this anyway, doing a lot more meetings via Skype? Are we going to change the way we work?
Yes, yeah. I think in the future, this will be a paradigm shift in everyone's lives. It won't go back to the way it was, but hopefully it can improve our way of being. And it means that I hope that once we are able to be, you know, freely sociable again, that our social atmosphere will transform into a more appreciation of our fellow human beings, of the lovely things they're doing, like meeting up with our friends and our loved ones, enjoying sitting having a drink in a nice pub. You know, we know people running pubs, and we want to support them and the venues and the arts, and appreciate it's not about making money. It's not about having, you know, everything you want in your luxurious life, if you've got one, if you're fortunate enough. The most important things now are people, and our love of our fellow human beings. And I know it sounds a bit hippie, namaste and all that, but I am, you know, of that mind. And I really, really feel for the people who are struggling and are going to struggle now because they're isolating. But there are support networks, phone people. I'm speaking to people a lot of the time, and I hopefully encourage everyone else to do that too. And I think that's the way we keep our personal contact going, and we keep our bonds together, we stay together, and we build on that, and we build our fellowship of man, is the phrase, I think, and woman, and those who are either, or both. So we share and support each other, and I think we'll get through that with ease, and then come out with actually probably something very, very beautiful at the end of it. I'm looking at the positives, and I think people should do that too.
Yeah, just before we finish up, there's been a lot of, we've spoken to Brighton Mutual Aid, there's been a lot of mutual aid, especially online, and kind of organisations set up, so because we need to look after the vulnerable and the elderly now, don't we? So this is a time to act, particularly food, getting essentials, and they might not be calling us or asking us directly because they might feel a bit embarrassed about that. So we need to kind of reach out to people directly, don't we, if we can, in the most appropriate way, of course.
Well, the useful things are in Brighton Hove, for example. I'm on these neighbourhood. Network, the neighbourhood groups. There are Facebook groups. Join those, get involved, and communicate with everyone else, because that mutual support network and community will help those people and actually volunteer it. Some people, older people, are too proud to ask for help. Offer it, you know, bang on the door, put a note through that so they don't speak directly to others, but stick a note through doors and neighbours and say hello and say, look, you know, do you need any help? I've been saying that to our neighbour and other people as well, and I think that's the way to go, is that offer help if you can, but also take care of yourself as well, wash your hands, all the usual advice. I've come up with a different song for washing my hands, and it's a full two choruses of Boris is a you-know-what. La 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 la. Do that twice, it's almost the right amount of time for washing your hands.
20 seconds. All right. I know we're going to be catch up regularly, Mark, so we'll leave it there for now. Stay safe, all the best, and we'll catch up again shortly. Cheers, Mark. Take care, thanks. See ya. Is that right? Should we do our interview tomorrow then, if you